received in our lives is by the mercies of the living God. It is by his mercies that we are called parents today. It is by his mercies that we are alive, hale and healthy. I had to lead us to sing that song because it is of his mercies that we are not consumed. Last year, about this time last year, we were all gathered here celebrating our children. I would like us to sing that song again to magnify him because he didn't allow us to lose any of our children. It is of his mercies that we are not consumed. Shoshelanu. Oshemilanu. Or you are a single lady or a single man, I'd like you to lift up your voice and celebrate Jesus, the giver of life, the preserver of your soul. Today is a unique day in the lives of children, and we are gathered to celebrate Jesus who made it possible. Lord, we worship you, we give you praise. I'd like you to appreciate him because he did allow you to mourn. Appreciate the one who has given you the privilege to be called mother, to be called a father. Oh, Father, we worship you. Thank God for those wonderful children God has given you. If you are yet to have a child, thank God for your life because you are a child to somebody. Father, we worship you. We give you all the praise. We are grateful to you. For all of these children, we have come to thank you. You didn't allow us to lose any. You are the strength of their lives. You are the one preserving their lives. You didn't allow kidnappers to kidnap them. You didn't allow sicknesses and diseases to snatch them away. Lord, we worship you. We give you all the praise. Blessed be your name. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. You may please take your seat. I want to celebrate every parent here in presence. And I want to celebrate the children. Children, shout hallelujah. Make it louder, hallelujah. Yes, it's a great privilege to be called a mother or to be called a father. And that's why we are celebrating today. This morning, I'd like to appreciate God for that privilege given to me to celebrate my own children. I hope you too will celebrate God for giving you that privilege to celebrate your own children. And if you are yet to be in that position, by the reason of today's celebration, may the Lord respond to you in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. The title of my message this morning is Repositioned to Shine. Repositioned to Shine. It's so important for us to know that God has a heritage of shining for every of our children. The Bible tells us that the seed of the righteous is mighty. Our children are not ordained to be little. They are not ordained to be strugglers. Our children are not ordained to struggle before they get to the top. Of course, we've got to pass through some levels of training before we get to the top. But our children are not ordained to just keep suffering and suffering without having the light at the end of any tunnel. God has ordained our children to shine. And I pray that your children will shine in the name of Jesus. Even you yourself, you have been ordained to shine. May your light shine brighter and brighter in the name of Jesus. The law of inertia makes it clear to us that every object in its permanent state of rest continues in that permanent state of rest. Or if it is moving, it continues moving. It continues to move unless compelled by an external force to act otherwise. And how does that apply to you as a parent? The life of your child remains on one spot. Or even if it is moving, it keeps moving, whether there is direction or no direction, until you take your stand to do something. Pastor said something at the beginning of this. I said the Lord told him that nothing moves until you move it. The destinies of your children will not move until you do something. It's not enough for us to just give back to those children and fold our hands. We may think it is by giving them food, 3 square meals, giving them milk, giving them protein, carbohydrate, making sure all the classes of food are in place. We may think those are the only things we need to do to ensure that the destinies of these children are intact. No, there are so many other things we need to do as parents. And I want to say this at this point. Some of these points that I'll be raising this morning, it is not compulsory that you are going to be the one. That's why the title of the message is Repositioned to Shine. That is, you are the one to place your children on that right track so that the destinies of God for their lives can be fulfilled. Hallelujah. The Bible, nature teaches about the moon. That the moon is, you know, for some people they will say the moon is a source of light. Despite the fact that, you know, it happens in the night. But let me say something to you. The moon has no light of its own. The only way it becomes possible for the moon to shine is because the moon positions itself. It aligns itself with the sun. And so the moon reflects the light from the sun. And so when you see the moon shining bright in the night, you may think, oh, this one too is a source of light. No, it is only reflecting the light from the sun. And I put this forth to you this morning. As parents, you are like that sun in the lives of your children. And until you position your children correctly, like the moon positions itself to shine, they may not shine. But I pray that your own children will shine in the name of Jesus. There is what nature puts in our children. There is what nurture puts in our children. Nature is the natural, how will I put it now? The natural makeup of our children. That is, if a child is coming, a child may not be too tall. That one is not your fault to an extent. A child may not come out fair. A child may be dark. A child may not be too intelligent. You know, all of those ones are products of nature. They are hereditary. They are genetical. They are things that they pick from you and your husband and your wife. And so if a child is not too intelligent, it is possible for you to be helping that child with the homework. And you keep giving the child a knock on the head. It's a combination of your own whatever and your husband's own. So please stop beating those children. Because you are the one. It is what you put into them that they are giving out to you. Hallelujah. I said that the moon has no light of its own. When you see a child, that child is a reflection of who the parents are. I do tell my children, when people see you, and you behave in an unruly manner, people will quickly, the picture of your parents will come to them and they preach, oh, and see their child. Did you get what I'm saying? So your own child reflects who you are. If your child dresses indecently, it's a reflection of who you are. If your child is unruly, if your child is not that intelligent, it is your fault. But most of the times we abdicate our responsibility to the school. If a child is not really doing well, it's not 100% the fault of the school. You check the genetic combination of yourself and your husband, or yourself and your wife, to see whether when you were in school, were you that intelligent? The 2 + 2 that you could not answer for when you were 7 years old, you start slapping the child who is just 4 years old to do 2 + 2. Hallelujah. So your child is a reflection of who you are. Whenever your child goes out, you just take a look at that child. That what will people say when they see my child? And even as singles, as young, you know, girls and boys in our midst this morning, you are a reflection of who your parents are. So it's so important for us to take that so seriously. We cannot just leave our children's destinies to chance. We've got to arise and do something. Even as a teenager or a pre-teenager or an adolescent, you've got to do something about your life. I've been talking about this concerning parents. I have this to say to you as a teenager. Even if you do not have parents, that's not an excuse. You can take your life by your hands. Jabez, you know, Jabez's background didn't speak so well about him. But did you know what Jabez did? Jabez took his destiny in his hands. So my parents don't have money to send me to school. It's not enough. I have several people that are working, sending themselves to school. Oh, my mother and my father, they weren't staying together. And so that's why my life is like that. It's a lie. I came out of a broken home. Hallelujah. So please do not look at yourself. Don't look at your background. Don't allow your background to put your back on the ground. Because your background does not have enough capacity. You are the one to determine what your destiny looks like. As a businessman, as a businesswoman, as a mother in the house, as a father, whosoever, as a career person, I say to you this morning that your destiny is in your hands. It is whatsoever you do with it that will matter. It is whatsoever you put into it. Your destiny is like sowing and reaping. Everything we do in life is like sowing and reaping. If you put your energy to sowing into your destiny, it's a matter of time. Within 10, 15 years, you begin to see the greatness in you emerging, and that will be your portion in the name of Jesus. And so it is so important for us as parents to take the destinies of our children in our hands, to do something. Like this song that says, don't sit down, fold your hands, think about your children, oh. What can you feel do to make them better? Oh yeah. Please tell somebody. You are not telling your friend. Hallelujah. So whatsoever it's within your reach to make the lives of your children better, please do it. In our own days, our parents would do so many things. They say, "Tori omo ni mo shengi ya, tori omo ni mo shengi ya." But in our own generation, mi o le waku o. But I want to tell you something. Sowing, whatsoever you sow is what you reap. You want those children, the time is coming that you expect those children to give back to you. And whatever you do for them now, it's what will determine what they will give back to you. It is a prayer of every parent that your children will be merciful in your old age. That will be your portion in the name of Jesus. Your children will not be callous in your old age. No, there are some children that will say, "Mommy, what is it again? Why are you calling me now?" So if you are the one, if your mommy is calling you now and you always grumble, you are sowing a seed. A time will come, you too will need the attention of your children, and you can be rest assured. Even when they don't want to do it, something in there will say, "Oh, busy Jerry." But that will not be our portion in the name of Jesus. And so how do we reposition our children to shine? I've said it, that they have a destiny of shining. They have great destinies. God has not made any child to serve the other. He said it in the book of Joel. He said, each of them will go in their paths and none shall break their rank. That is, the cloud is so wide for every child to shine. So you don't need to envy this person's child. I don't need to envy your child. Because as long as I position my own child, my child has the capacity to shine. And they will shine in the name of Jesus. And so what kind of parents are we supposed to be? Or do we ought to be to reposition our children to shine? First and foremost, you've got to be a connector. As a parent, you are a connector. God has ordained you to connect your children to two different sources. One, you connect them to the real source of light. You know, without light, you can't shine. And that's why the moon had to position itself to reflect the light of the sun. So your children are waiting on you. You are the one to position them to reflect the light of the true source, which is Jesus. You are a connector. You are there to connect your children to the real source. Are you connecting your children to God? I am not talking about morning devotion, because there is more to connecting your children to the true source than morning devotion. In so many homes, morning devotion is like a ritual. It's like, something you must just do. But in different ways, we connect our children. Have you ever asked if your child is born again? Or even you yourself, are you born again? Because if your child isn't seeing anything, I said it, that your children will reflect the light that they see in you. You are their first teacher, not the school. So whatsoever goes on in your own life, can they really look at you and say really that you are a believer? Can they really see you as somebody who is connected to Jesus? You connect them by praying with them. It's not just praying when there is trouble. It's not just praying like a parent. She won't allow those children to go without anointing them. The day you are not there to anoint them, what will those children do? We must teach our children to be independent. And that's why you need to teach them to have a personal relationship with God. Jesus said, without me, you can do nothing. He is that in him is light. So without Jesus, without connecting our children to Jesus, without making them to do things that are spiritual, forget it, they cannot be connected to God. And without them being connected to the source of light, how will they shine? But our children will not struggle in the name of Jesus. So it is so important for us to connect our children to the source of light, to the source of life, to the source of progress, to the source of success in life. Without Jesus, the struggle continues. Without Jesus, our children, they have no hope. But when you connect them, they have their personal relationship with Jesus. The day you will not be there, those children, you know, their relationship with God will pick them up. It's so important for us. How can we develop how can we help our children to develop their relationship with God? Model spirituality in your home. Is it only when you come to church that they see you carry the Bible? Is it only when it's praise and worship time that they see you sing? Is it only when you just bought a new car that they see you say praise the Lord? They are looking at you. As a matter of fact, these children, they learn more from what they see than what you say to them. Whatever you say to them is for yourself. But what they see, it sticks into them more. When there is trouble in the house, how do you handle it? How do you respond? Do you say all kinds of negative things to yourself, or you model faith, you model hope to your children? It's so important for us to teach our children how to pray. You teach them how to pray different kinds of prayers. There are so many children, if you ask them to pray, they will open their eyes will be open. You know that in this house they don't pray. But there are some, you see them, they will be praying, you know, even if they don't even know what they are saying, you know that in this particular house they pray. Teach your children how to pray. So many of them, the only thing when you ask them to pray, my mommy will not die in Jesus' name. My father will not die in Jesus' name. My mommy will not show Ibruku in Jesus' name. There are so many ways you teach your children to pray. But when they are yet to see you praying, then it becomes a difficult task. You show them by modeling to them what it is to pray. So it's so important, teach your children to pray. As they grow older, ask them, have you prayed this morning? Don't just assume that what that Batoti told you, but you should be able to, you know, you are independent. You should be able to take up your life by yourself. Ask them, have you prayed? Then the study of the word. Have you studied the Bible this morning? How many times do they see you study the Bible? Maybe most of the time, you just, whenever you carry your Bible, is to recite Psalm 35. Oluwa gboguta anton gboguti mi. Fijafa anton fijafa mi. Fawaka yofa adayo. Maybe those are the things to do. Or maybe you keep the Bible under your pillow so that you won't have a nightmare. Psalm 91, you open it and keep it under the Bible, under your pillow. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. You now say, Emma Bokawaba me, you meet it here. You now put the Bible under your pillow. When you train your children this way, they will not be strong in the Lord. And we must raise our children to be strong in the Lord because they need it. Spirituality cannot be overemphasized when it comes to child rearing. Because there will always be times you won't be there. It is so important for us to connect our children with the right source. Hallelujah. Connect your children with the right source by your obedience to the will of God. Like somebody may say, the pastor, son church, this is what we will do in this house. You are indirectly teaching, disconnecting those children from the ways of God. How many times have they seen you walk in the light of the world? There was a lady. She has all girls. And so there was a day, the lady now brought those children to me. And she said, is it not that the Bible says, children, honor your parents in the Lord? Did you know what the children said? They said, hey, mommy. The Bible also said, parents, do not provoke your children. Why are you provoking us? That is not to tell you that because you are a parent, you've got to be perfect. We are not perfect. We keep learning every day. But our obedience to the things of God, we help our children, we help position them. What would have happened if Joseph and Mary, yes, if they weren't obedient to the things of God? Immediately the angel went to Joseph. The angel first went to Mary, told her. Joseph wanted to do what was on his mind. The angel came to Joseph, you must not do it, this is the way you should go. Yes, sir, he went. When it was time to leave where they were, the angel came again, get up, rise, because they are looking for the life of this child to kill. Immediately he arose. Are you an obedient parent? Because if you are not obedient, you may not be able to position your child to shine. You may be the obstacle in the lives of your children. When God wakes you up in the morning, in the middle of the night, tap, 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 you say, oh, it's just 2 a.m. now. Why am I waking up kele kele like this? Maybe the Holy Spirit is waking you up to pray, to intercede for your children. You just go back to sleep. God deserves your obedience. He needs your obedience for the sake of your children. And the other connecting factor is the world. Connect your children to the world. Expose your children. There was a day we were going out. Then a child was saying, hey, see Mr. Biggs. Hey, see Moto. Hey, see this. Hey. I said, this one, you've not been exposed. Take your children out. Expose them. Take them to any eatery. Let them see it. Take them to where they will use the cutlery to eat. Take them, teach them etiquettes. Teach them, let them be socially intelligent. Don't just keep them in the house. They need to be exposed. Maybe a child has never seen an escalator before. And you say, Yes, you know I work with children. And these are the things that I see. Please expose them. Take them to Ikeja shopping mall. Let them go over the escalator. There was a day I took Ayomide there. I said, yes now. Will she say she has never seen it again? Mm-hmm. I took her there, so yeah, go here. Do like this. I pushed her. We went upstairs. There was nothing to do upstairs. We came down again. Expose your children. Take them to the cinema. Don't just put them in the house and give them fufu and apple to whatever to eat. They are like they. You've got to connect them. And another thing is the kind of school you send your children to. I'm not advertising, no. I'm just saying my own. The kind of school you take your children to. There was a time a parent came. She said, before I bring my child to your school, I want to attend your end of year events. And you know what she said? She said, I purposely came to know the kinds of children that my children will be mingling with. Is she wrong? Was she being proud or arrogant? No. Because birds of a feather will flock together. If you keep your children with Yenko Yoto, Babenko Yodo, that's all shall it be. All those words prayers will not do. I'm still coming to prayers, but everything is not praying. Even Jesus himself said, watch and pray. Look at the kind of children. There is one public school around us, I won't point to any direction. I said to myself that along with Ledu, my mother came from Mamilo Siglu school. Yes, because you need to see them. You can imagine what kind of adults will come out of this kind of school. I saw some other children when because of financial constraints, they had to go there. And after a while, I started seeing them and I said to them, excuse me, is this your foundation? Because you are now in their midst. See the way you are dressed. Come on, dress well. But that is just the little I can do. As long as they mingle, so will it be. Somebody told me, said, there is this environment that the way he sees young guys around, that he doesn't even want his own children to grow in this environment. Lest you begin to think it is by hanging around that you show yourself as a guy. In the morning, you see them in twos, four, five. They will just be hanging around corners. Expose your children. Watch where you take them to. Summertime is coming now. You want to have your free time. Just say, hello, holiday. You are not even scrutinizing where they are going for holidays. I don't leave my children. Now they are on their own. But in those days, it's only one place that they can go. And because I'm sure of what will be there. Don't leave your children to in the hands of parents who are careless. And somebody somewhere, one uncle that they will leave six girls with, we start molesting and abusing them. Don't just keep your children anywhere. They can't just go and do holiday anywhere because you are their connector. Whatsoever happens in their life, you have a hand in it. And that's why you've got to be careful. And the Lord will help us in Jesus' name. So I said, you've got to be a connector. Another thing is you've got to be a trainer. You've got to be your child's life coach. And I said earlier that some of these things, it's not compulsory, you are the only one doing them. You may not be able to be the life coach of your child, But you are the one to train your child. The Bible says, train up a child in the way he should go. And when he is old, he will not depart from it. That child that decided to start coming home by 10 p.m. It was because when the child was 6 years old, it is by 9:30 that I started asking, is he in your room? Is Toluwafemi in your room? Is she in your room? Has she slept in your room? Has she eaten? And now the child is like 18. She's so used to coming home by 10, and you are now screaming. Train up a child in the way that he should go. When he is old, he will not depart from it. You are the one to train your children. Train them to respect God, to reference God. Train them to reference you, to obey you. Because they will always need your instructions. A child that is left to himself will only bring shame. If the Bible says to his mother, to the father, go, Papa. See the child, she said yes. Hallelujah. So a life coach, what does a life coach do? A life coach will help you to take your child from where your child is now to where your child ought to be. Your child needs to be encouraged from time to time. Your child needs to be motivated from time to time. But you may not be able to do everything. But you need to locate a life coach for your children. A life coach that will help them to develop a positive self-concept. If a child is shy, as a parent, you are the trainer. You are the one to help that child to overcome that shyness. Maybe you as an adult, you are still very shy. If you are shy here, please, can you raise your hand? Be truthful, though, if you are shy. I'm talking about adults. If you are shy, you are a shy person. Okay, any other shy person, look at them. Okay, you are shy. You know the reason why you are still shy as an adult? Because there was nobody to help you to come out of it. Shyness is not genetical. You can actually come out of it. Maybe your shyness is as a result of you not being pleased with the way you are. You not being happy with yourself. Maybe somebody has told you that you are too short, you are too fat, you are too tall, you are too this, you are too that. If anybody says that, you tell the person, shut up, that's your opinion. Then begin to look out for good things about you. You've got to help your children to discover their potentials. Stop comparing your children with other people's children. That one, does he have two heads? This one that is becoming first in the class. She the head, she has two heads. If she like, let her have four heads. For me, oh. Don't compare your children. Celebrate the giftings in the lives of your children. A child may not really know, you know, may not score 90 over 100 in math. That child may not score 95 over 100 in English like some other people. But when it comes to the issue of dance, this girl can dance. And you now say, Shejola Anre Lo School Lojo, it is part of it. Don't you compare your children with other people's children. Instead, celebrate the greatness in the life of your children. As an adult, don't compare yourself with anybody. I don't have to compare myself with anybody. If you like, wear anything you like, that's your business. If you like, drive whatever you like, that's your business. If you like, whatever you do with your life is your business. What I am doing, I'm not competing with anybody, but I'm competing with my destiny, making sure that I become the best that I could ever be. So your children, you know, each one has its own destiny. Even twins, you can compare them. You can say, no, somebody said, why are you giving them different homework? Are they not twins? I said, okay, this one is your first issue, that is why. Because they don't have the same kind of brain. They don't assimilate the same way. So you don't expect us to give the same kind of assignment. Because Taiwo can write 1 to 10, does not mean Kainde must write 1 to 10. Kainde may write 1 to 5, but she will take her time and she will write well. Taiwo can write 1 to 10, but there are 2 we face here. 5 will be like this. You know, you must look out for something to celebrate in your children. And even in yourself too. Have you ever looked at yourself and... is there no good thing about you? There are so many good things about you. It's because you have not taken time to check. When you begin to compare your own weakness with somebody else's strength, depression sets in. You now think you are lesser. No, you are not. Because the one who created us is no respecter of persons. He didn't create one to be better than the other. Mm-mm. It is when we got to this world that nature and nurture we interact. And the one, if your nurturing style is not okay, that is when your children, not your own children, that is why those children will be backwards. Every child, did you see any child who came with clothes to the world? No. Everybody came. They came the same way. They came with a clean slate. So it is your own duty to begin to determine what am I writing on the slates of my children. By your actions, by your steps, by your knowledge. All of this will help you to begin to write on the slates of the lives of your children. As a life coach will help your children to set goals. I asked my son one time, I said, you are saying this, you are saying this, you are saying, write out your life goals. Write them out. A life coach will help your children to set goals. Have you ever asked your child, what would you like to become? I mean, it is what you want to become. You want to become a lawyer, so you say, you become a lawyer. Like somebody said, they said, this child cannot, will not do well in science class. I say, engineer lewa niye, and shape niye. And I say, maybe somebody has seen vision, and they have told her that this guy will be an engineer. You need common sense or to weigh visions. If somebody had told you that this child will be an engineer, and you found out that this child will be good, just counting money, instead of attending to iron and steel, you better leave that child and forget about that prophecy. Any prophecy that you cannot, that has no one or two witnesses, you drop it. Any prophecy that is not in line with God's word, for whatever God will have you do, he would have equipped you. So if you lack that, ability, then you need to think twice. You've got to help your children to set goals. You've got to help them to, you've got to see them as a superstar. Celebrate that one thing about them. Oh, my child can dance. Wow, dance for me, let me see. You see, I found out that the only way by which you can help a child to improve is by locating one good thing that child loves, and you use that. The Holy Spirit taught me that, and I read it on Facebook 2 days ago. Everybody was saying, which way will this person go? Which way will this child go? They said, let her go to this school. Let her go to that school. But the Holy Spirit said to me, if you are going to help this child, give her what she loves doing. Because if she's not happy with herself, if she's not good in her own eyes, then there is no other thing you can help that child to achieve. And so I now called the girl, you now, what do you like doing? She told me. I said, that's the path you will follow. And ever since then, that's when she will come on to tell you that, I did this, I did that. Before then, if you tell her to do the other way around, nawala, she will squeeze her face will change. But until we were able to locate that area of stress, something that she loves doing, and we gave it to her, that was when she started, getting fulfilled. If you are not fulfilled with whatever you are doing, you can't be your best. If you are not fulfilled with that business, with that career, you cannot shine. It's a lie, forget it. Because frustration we always set in. And frustration we always set in to everybody. But your passion, your desire to achieve will be the one to push you. But if there's no motivation, then you may get weary. So it's so important for us to locate that superstar. Celebrate them. Tell them you are great. You are an intelligent child. I love you. Oh, that's my boy. I'm so proud of you. It is not only when results has come. I say, you score 90 years, you score 40 years, you score 30 years, you score 60 years. When you were their age, what did you score? So help them to see themselves as inner superstars. Then help them to live for a purpose. Ask them, when you grow up, what do you want to become? You as an adult, ask yourself, where am I going? By the time I am 50, where do I want to find myself? It's so important. Because Bishop Oyedepo said, to live without goals is to live like a goat. If you wake up in the morning and the only thing you do is you want to dress to go out without thinking of what to achieve that day, you may not really make the best. Teach them to overcome obstacles. Because a child scored 30% in math, you can always tell the child, you have the mind of Christ. You will be better. You can be better. And you walk towards it. If you need to get an extra teacher for your child, do something about it. If you need to sit with the child, do something about it. Don't just talk and talk and talk. Most of the time, we just talk to these children without taking, concrete steps. It's so important. Don't teach them that failure is final. You may fail this time. That's not the end of your life. A child was told that if you don't score 280, because the parents want that child to study medicine. Say, if you don't score 280, don't come to the house. And the child scored 275. and I'm waiting for them. Shebi, your own child scored 275. The one that scored 171, will the parents kill him or her? Let's celebrate these children. I promise that man, the day I see him, I will show him. Sir, did you write jam? Yes, now maybe if you are not school starts attempted. Did you write jam? What did you score? Don't give your child an unnecessary target to meet. Help them to overcome obstacles. A child failed and the parent said, I will not attend your graduation. That's absurd. That's not the way. Will you throw the child away with the bath water? When your children need you to encourage them, please encourage them. When they have failed, help them to overcome obstacles. And the Lord will help us in Jesus' name. Help them to manage their emotions. There are times a child may not be, may be quick to talk. A child, like one child this morning, because they didn't bring skirt for her, she started crying. And I just snapped at her. Oh, come on, why are you crying? Clean your face. Instead of you to look out for a solution, you are crying. So what's the solution? Say, somebody will give us skirt. Hey, take the skirt and move on. I say, you are crying. Oh, Daniel, you are crying. That is what so many of us do. You just start comparing them. You be abusing them. Instead of taking steps, positioning them to be able to become emotionally stable. So you've got to help your children to be stable emotionally. Then you've got to become an intercessor. I've said it that you've got to become a connector as a parent for you to be able to reposition your children to shine. You've got to become a life coach, a trainer. Don't leave the training of your children to the school. It's not just for the school. Now you've got to become an intercessor. There is this account in the Bible concerning Solomon. Bathsheba might have done something wrong. Okay, she committed adultery and she gave birth to, she committed adultery with a king and she gave birth to Solomon. But David had already said it, that after him, Solomon will take his place. And so when somebody else was to be enthroned, the mother of Solomon, Bathsheba, she went. She said, King, but you were the one that said it's my son that will reign. What is now happening? The king said, your son will be enthroned. Intercession. What is intercession? Standing in the gap for somebody. Are you really standing in the gap for your children? Because you've got to stand in the gap for them. Bombarding heaven with your prayers so that something tangible will happen in the lives of your children. Nothing just happens. Ask John Wesley what the mother did. Ask so many people, that are really doing well, what their parents are doing. There was a day my son told me, he told me something, I said, yay. He said, Mommy, keep quiet. Don't stop shivering. There are so many things happening, that one thing I know is that there is somebody praying for me somewhere. And that's why I kept on escaping. So there are so many things that are happening in the lives of these children. So many things happening in the spirit realm that you know nothing about. But when you go on your knees to stand in the gap, is there anything that you are seeing in the life of your child that you are not at home with? And the only thing you keep saying is, Bo she man she niye. You too, kilo wa fe she si. You've got to do something about it. If a child steals, don't sit and fold your hands. If a child is a liar, don't sit and fold your hands. If a child is not doing well academically, don't sit and fold your hands. Stand! Stand your ground and pray for that child. Pray for that child. Because until you pray for that child, you may not be able to reposition the life of that child. If Jabez could pray for himself, that's how it concerns you. If you are old and you don't even have a parent to pray for you, Jabez did that for himself. His parents didn't see anything good in him, but he saw something good. You as a parent, it is your duty to go on your knees and pray for your children. I'm not talking about, Lord, bring him to school safely and bring him back safely. There are so many other deep-rooted issues that we've got to pray for our children about. And it's so important for us to ensure that we intercede for our children. Because intercession will pave way for them. It will reposition them. When you pray, something happens. It's not enough for you to keep them in the house and make them mama, mommy get inside. It's not enough. At times you need to leave them, let them go out and pray for them. That happened to me. When my children started gaining independence, it would be like, hey, what will happen to them? Will they go and come back? Will they go and come back? And I wouldn't want them to go. There was a day Joshua almost fought. He was hung, he was furious. And as he said, mommy, you're always afraid. Allow us to go out. They want to go out, but your prayers can always cover them. And so now when they are going out, I hand you over to God. Pray about their future. Last week, Pastor Kalaole said something. He said, the trouble that is waiting for me in the future over my children, that Lord destroy it. Haven't you seen children who are supposed to be blessing their parents in their old age? And it's their parents that will be running from one place to the other over their lives. You will not run here and there for your children. When a child is sick, when a child is yet to attain a particular, you know, cadre or level, when that child is supposed to be there, the mother will start running about. The kind of prayer that you should be praying for them when you are old is for God to preserve them and to continue to bless them. Not that God bless them. What have you been doing all this while? So it is now time for you to speak into the future of those children. Pray about their academics. Pray about their health. Pray about everything as they go to school, as they return. Pray about everything. Pray about the wife and the husband they will marry. You can't wait. You've got to intercede. When you intercede for your children, it prepositions them. Did you see what happened at that wedding in Cana of Galilee? It was an intercessor that repositioned that party, the couples. They would have been, you know, in shame. They would have experienced shame that day. But their lives were repositioned because somebody spoke to Jesus about them. Have you spoken to Jesus about your son? Have you spoken to Jesus? Or do you talk to Jesus? Not spoken. It has to be continuous. Do you talk to Jesus on a regular basis about your children? As you do so, the Lord will bless you in the name of Jesus. So you've got to be an intercessor. It is so important. Also, you've got to be a cleaner. Somebody will say cleaner again. You've got to be a cleaner. Because as parents, your children will mess up. Is that not so? When they mess up, what do you do? When your children has done, when your child has done something wrong outside, can that child be bold enough to come to you that, mommy, I did this morning, and you will know how to handle it? If your child experienced something out there, can that child come back home to tell you that this and this and this happened to me today, mommy or daddy, and you will know how to handle it well? If a child came back from school to tell you that somebody just wrote a love letter to me, what will you do as a parent? You will start beating the child. And so when the child is going to nursery, look at the way she's dressed. You are going to meet them, Abby. That child will never come back to tell you anything. They will mess up. They will do silly things. But how do we bring them back? When you discipline them, most of the time we punish. We don't discipline. When we discipline in love. Discipline them, correct them, and hope for the best. You can't throw the bathwater, the child away with the bathwater. Because the child has done something wrong, does that mean he or she is no longer your child? No. Even God does not deal with us that way. When our children make mistakes, let's do something to bring them back. If a child gets pregnant, for example, some people we send that child out. That is not the way to do it. If a child has done something wrong, okay, I watched a film and they said, this child will face the law. The father said, let them jail him. That's not a good father. And that's why it's so important for us to always be there for them. When you have taken your time to do your training properly, that child will not take you to the police station. That child will not take you to where your feet should not go to. So it is so important for us, no matter how busy you are, reposition your children. Do all you can to make sure you straighten their destinies out before it is too late. There is always this general saying that it is better that precaution is better than cure. When you prevent something, it is better than you looking for the cure. So it is high time for us as parents to reposition the lives of our children by taking our stand as real parents. When they do something that is wrong, correct them. Correct them in love. Don't just beat a child and leave that child. When you spank a child, call that child again. Even you may even pet the child. The Yorubas will say when you use the left hand to scold a child, you use the right hand to draw her back to yourself so that that child will be able to learn. Most often when we train, when we discipline our children, the talking and the beating will not do them any good because we have not done it in love. Show them, tell them the reason why you have to spank them. And everything is not about spanking. Or else it will just be, yes, you want to give 12, take 1, 2, 3. You want my back, take it. So everything is not about beating. There are so many other different ways by which we can help our children to come out of, you know, bad behaviors. And the Lord will help us in Jesus' name. And so it's so important for us. You are the cleaner in the lives of your child. When that child is going out, check the child. Have you dressed well? Don't say he's 17 years old. Will I still be monitoring him? Me, I still do it though. I have different kinds of comb. So that when somebody goes out and the hair is not properly combed, I bring out my comb to comb the hair properly. That's why the father, they feel they are guys. And I always tell them, I'm only doing my duty as a mother because they are the reflection of who I am. Whenever, and there is one thing I want us to know, in cleaning up for them, don't get tired. For the fact that you have been saying it since 1964 or since the beginning of 2019, and it's like they are not responding, that does not mean they will not respond. Repetition is the mother of skill, and that is what they need. Keep telling them. You say, you have not combed your hair. I forgot. You go back. The next morning again, you have not combed your hair. I won't be tired. I will keep saying it. A time will come, they will align. But other, is it every time I will be talking to you about it? Is it every time, blah, blah, blah? So it is so important for us to repeat and repeat and repeat. And you see that very soon, they will become whom you want them to be. You are also a molder. You are a molder. If you were given a piece of plasticine to mold, to do something with it, it is whatever you mold in the lives of your children that becomes theirs. Model good character. If you are not hospitable, you just find out that your children are not hospitable. If you are the hostile type, ento konraju, you just find out that gradually your children are just like that. If you are not spiritual, you just find out that your children will not be spiritual, even though you cry and cry and push them to church. You've got to model good behavior. What kind of behavior are you modeling? Are you modeling to them that you are a giver? Are you modeling love for self, love for God, and love for other people? Somebody, it was posted somewhere. The man went to buy rubber shoes for his son. That since you, all you know is to make fun of a child who wears rubber sandals, you are not back over Sherry. You are the one to mold them. That is to help that child to understand that it's a privilege. For whatever you are, wherever you have found yourself, it's a privilege. But much more, when you are never around, how will you be able to mold them? You've got to be around them all the time. When you are around them, you'll be able to know what is wrong with them per time. When a child has changed his attitude, you'll be able to know. But when you are never around, today you are this, tomorrow you are here, today you are this, tomorrow you are there, you've got to be there for them. You've got to be able to spend time with your children. You are their cleaner. Clean them up. Let them model good character. You are there, you are there for them to help them to mold a destiny that is worth it. Help them to model academic excellence. Because if you are not there, when they are doing the assignment, your teacher has given you the assignment, you pack your books and go. All you are telling that child is that school is not that important. And research has this to tell us, that parents who are always there to motivate their children do better in school than parents who will just say, I have paid school fees. So somebody said, that's why I brought my child to this type of a school. I say, we are not the parents. You are. So don't just say because you are paying fees, then what you should do, you won't do. When a child comes home to tell you that there's going to be a competition in school, sit with that child and run through it together. Now somebody now came first. You started crying that your child didn't come first. I said, The one who came first, do you know what the kind of effort that the parents put into that competition? So you are the one to mold these children. Mold them to be godly. Mold them to reference God. Mold them to respect people. Mold them to be of good character. Mold them to be honest. When you go to parties, they see you. When you come back, you carry their canned drinks, you carry their money, you carry their meat. You are modeling dishonesty. Don't say, and your mama bow. So when they too, they go to parties, they'll put one canned drink here. They'll put La Casera here. They'll put everything and they'll go. Model honesty. Don't let them catch you taking what does not belong to you. If you are not a person of integrity, forget it. Your children will learn. They will learn from it. If they sent you something to buy for them in church and you keep the change, and the child, you ask the child, do calculation for me. Yes, ma, it's 19,500. Okay, keep that 500. Go and use it to buy pala fish. That is our own gain. You are teaching them what is wrong. So whatever I said it at the beginning, that your children reflect who you are. So whatever you are seeing in your child, check yourself. Is that who you are? Because somehow, that child must have picked it somewhere. It's so important for us. You are a molder. Make sure you mold good character. Let them see you. Demonstrate faith. When there is trouble, show them the correct way to go. It is not by crying. Show them that it's by the word. It's by taking communion. It's by sprinkling the blood. It's by using the anointing. It's by speaking the word of God. Let them see that in you. Because until they are able to see that, they won't become that. And these are the little things put together that will position your children for greatness. And I want to say lastly, that you are their prophets. They need a prophet. You may not necessarily be the direct prophet. I said that at the beginning also. That all of these things that I'm talking about, it doesn't mean you should be the only one doing it. Look for people around you. Connect them with people. Destiny helpers. Connect them with people that will help them. Hallelujah. You are their prophets. Speak good things to their lives. The only thing a child has ever heard from the parents is the negative. Bori esheri, bese esheri, bakpe esheri, bonru esheri, the way you are in school, the way you walk, the way you dress, the way you eat. The negative things are the things that you keep saying about your children. Speak forth into their lives. Prophesy into their lives. Let's take them to church. That's why it's so important for them to attend church service. Let them attend church service. When it is singles program, don't keep them in the house. That is not the time for them to be washing clothes for you. That is not the time for them to take them out. Push them out into their destiny. That was what the mother of Moses did. The mother of Moses waited for some time. And knowing fully well that she had a proper child, she waited for that correct time and she pushed the boy out. And she didn't just push the boy out. She kept on monitoring. She installed a tracker to Moses. And that tracker was the sister. So it is not just enough for you to just push your children out, all in the name of independence. You've got to install a tracker. I'm not saying go and look for a tracker now. But you've got to monitor them. That's what I'm saying. When a child goes to school, there should be a time for you to return. That child cannot just come back whenever he likes. That child cannot just wake up whenever he likes. You've got to monitor them to ensure that they become the kind of adults that you want them to become. Speak into their lives. Let them get connected to people of God so that when there is an issue, even if they cannot tell you, there should be a prophet over their lives to help them, come out of it. They need a life coach. They need a prophet. And you yourself, you are also a prophet in the life of your child by speaking good things into the lives of your children. Hallelujah. It is my prayer that as you do all of this to reposition your children will shine in the name of Jesus. Your children will rise up early to call you blessed in the name of Jesus. They will not just be mean children. Your children will not be backbenchers in the name of Jesus. And I receive grace for you to become the kind of friends that God expects you to be, so that your children's destiny will be secured in the name of Jesus. Please rise on your feet. I want you to pray for those children. Decree over their lives that even as God has ordained them to shine, if your parents are not here, if you are a young adult, go ahead and speak to your life. I have been destined to shine. I receive grace to shine in the name of Jesus. I will shine from one level of glory to the other. Parents, pray for those children. Your children will not serve their mates. Your children will walk in the high places of the earth. Your children will be great. The seed of the righteous is mighty. Your children will do great feats. Your children will be among the nobles in their generation. Your children will climb higher. Speak greatness into their lives. They will shine. They will shine because the path of the just is as a shining light that shines more and more unto a perfect day. Open your mouth and speak life to the future of your children. Speak life to your own future. You are ordained to shine. Your light will not go dim. You will not walk in darkness. All the days of your life, you will not walk in darkness. It shall be well with you. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. You are also going to pray, repositioning the destinies of your children. Just like Pastor Kolawole encouraged us to pray last week, that every plan of the enemy waiting for me over the lives of my children in the future, I bring them down in the name of Jesus. If you don't have a child to pray for yourself. Every plan of the enemy waiting for me to fight me in the future over the lives of my children. Every plan of the enemy waiting for me to use me as trouble in the lives of my parents, I come against it in the name of Jesus. Open your mouth and pray. Concerning their marital life, you will not run helter-skelter. Concerning their health, you will not run helter-skelter. The enemy will not use your children against you. Every plan of the enemy over the lives of your children, bring them down in the name of Jesus. Every tree that my father has not planted that is growing in the lives of my children, I uproot you in the name of Jesus. I uproot sickness. I uproot truancy. I uproot every evil spirit. I uproot every bad behavior. Whatsoever the Lord has not planted, I uproot. I root out. I pull out in the name of Jesus. My children will go forward. My children will give me rest. It shall come to pass that these children will rise early. The name of Jesus will be glorified in my children. Thank you, Father, for in Jesus' most precious name we have prayed. Please, you may take your seat.